The history of the de Havilland Mosquito has been well documented. In real terms, it was probably the first multi-role combat aircraft, a heritage that has continued on to the present day with the Tornado and, more recently, the Typhoon. During its 10-year production run, over 7,000 aircraft were built in various versions.
In 1943, the Mosquito was required to carry a 6-pound quick-firing gun. It was a field weapon weighing nearly a ton, and it had a kick like a mule. This also entailed carrying half a ton of armour, steel plates up to 3/8 of an inch thick to protect the engines from enemy cannons.
The weapon chosen was the Molins 57mm Type M, which was based on the Ordnance QF 6-pounder anti-tank gun used by the British and American armies. The Molins company modified the gun and designed a 21-shell automatic magazine capable of firing 55 rounds a minute. A single prototype, a converted FB Mark VI, was built in secrecy and officially designated the Mark 18. In service, it was usually referred to as the TSETSE, after the vicious biting fly of Africa. The Molins gun and magazine were fitted in the cannon bay along with extra armour plating. The four machine guns were left in place. At the time, there were differences within the RAF between those who preferred rocket projectiles over big guns. Ultimately, rockets won the day, and only 17 production Mark 18s were built. In February 1944, a special detachment of Mark 18 TSETSEs from 618 Squadron joined 248 Squadron at Predanic in Cornwall. They flew alongside Mosquito Mark 6s against shipping and U-boats entering and leaving the bases along the French Atlantic coast. Flight Lieutenant Des Curtis, DFC, was a navigator with a secret 618 Squadron test flying Mosquitoes fitted with the Barnes-Wallis highball bouncing bomb intended for use against the German surface fleet. In the event, the highball was never used in action. He joined 618 SD, Special Detachment Flight.
We reported back to RAF Benson to be asked, why are you here? You should be at Predanic. Well, where is Predanic, we asked, and they said it's somewhere in the south of Cornwall. What are we going to do down there? Well, when you get there, how do we get there? And they said, well, there's an Oxford coming in from Shawbury maintenance unit. Later on, we might persuade him to fly you down to RAF Predanic, which we did. So we went down to this place, Predanic, which was a satellite airfield a few miles from the Lizard Peninsula, where we met up with the former flight commander of 618 Squadron, Charlie Rose, who had been doing much of the experimental flying with the bouncing bomb. And we formed 618 Special Detachment. There were three crews, and we were then told that an aircraft was coming down from RAF Boscombe Down, the research establishment, with another secret weapon. In fact, we went up to Boscombe Down to collect this aircraft, which turned out to be a Mosquito Mark 18, the fighter bomber version. But this time, the cannons had been removed, and in its stead, or in their stead, I should say, a 57mm 6-pounder anti-tank gun had been mounted in the fuselage. But a little while later, one of the other chaps, a Canadian, was out on his own, and he came across a German U-boat and severely damaged it. And it had to return. It was on its way out for a mission. It had to return to base and was out of service for a long, long time. So we were starting to adjust the balance a little. move on to March 1944, by which time the Germans had come to realize that there was, amongst the Mosquitoes, there was a rather dangerous version firing this gun. So we were then given a fighter escort, and a typical formation for us was the two aircraft with the Molins big gun, which we called a TSETSE aircraft because it's more dangerous than a standard Mosquito. And we were escorted by four fighter versions, Mark 6 fighter versions from another squadron or from our own squadron. 25th of March, we went down to Point C, which was a mineswept channel leading to Saint-Nazaire harbour, and just started in on the channel when we suddenly saw some ships on the horizon. We were down then to about 50 feet off the sea, 40 or 50 feet off the sea. As soon as we recognized that they were ships, we pulled up to find a German U-boat was just meeting up with the minesweepers and destroyer that had been sent out to accompany it back to port. Our four escorts started firing at the minesweepers while we climbed into the sun with ourselves and Hilly Hilliard as our number two, climbed into the sun to 1,500 feet, turned about, and then we made the first attack onto the U-boat. We managed to get five rounds of this solid shell off before we hit, before we had to pull out of the dive, and Hilly followed us, firing also. We didn't aim for the U-boat, strangely enough. We aimed for the water just to the side of the U-boat, because the trajectory of that shell, which was solid steel, when it hit the water pressure caused it to change direction so that it ran parallel to the surface and would therefore penetrate the hull of the U-boat. And not being explosive but solid shell, it would then ricochet within the U-boat, and if it hit something like the engine block of the U-boat, it would then ricochet and most probably burst its way out of the shell of the U-boat elsewhere. So you had two holes for the price of one. We managed to hit it five times. We saw then that the U-boat had stopped weaving away and had slowed down. There was a big patch of what was diesel oil on the water, and they had stopped firing at us. The gun was obviously out of action on board the U-boat. So we assumed that they were abandoning ship, and 20 minutes later we were on our way back to RAF Pradhanuk. We learnt that that U-boat U-976 sank within 20 minutes of our first sighting it. Four of the crew were mortally wounded, but they were picked up by the minesweepers, and the others were all 47 of the remaining crew were picked up safely and returned to base. And that then was our first major success. Move on to the following month, we by then had acquired a new commanding officer, Tony Phillips, and we went out to another mineswept channel further down the Atlantic coast, where we met a big convoy including some destroyers and about 10 Ju-88 aircraft circling above. They were determined to get this U-boat safely into port, and we had a ding-dong battle there. In the process of which we were following Tony Phillips, our number one, and he came up behind a Ju-88 and let fire with our 57mm gun and hit the Ju-88, hit the port engine, and literally the port engine was taken out of its mountings and separated from the Ju-88, which then slowly spiraled down into the sea, crashed into the sea. So we'd actually finished up shooting down an aircraft with this anti-U-boat gun.
By August 1944, the Allied advance in Europe had driven away suitable targets for 248 Squadron, so the squadron, including the Mark 18s, moved to Banff in Scotland to form part of the Banff Strike Wing, attacking shipping and other targets on the Norwegian coast. One of the TSETSE pilots was Flight Lieutenant Brian Beattie of 248 Squadron. Interviewed in 2016, he gives a pilot's view of the Mark 18.
248 Squadron were stationed at St. Evel in Cornwall. And the flight I was posted to was known as the TSETSE flight. This was also known as the SD flight, the Special Detachment. It had originally been half of 618 Squadron. The other half went on to develop the highball second generation bouncing bomb, but the TSETSE half was equipped with the 6-pounder 57mm Molins gun, so called, and it was never officially number 3 flight or number C flight. It was always just the SD, which made me feel very special, because I thought initially it meant special duties, but it wasn't. It was merely special detachment. I learned there whilst down in Cornwall how to fire this gun, including also getting a bit more familiar with the Mosquito. After a short time in St. Evel, the whole squadron was posted up to Banff in Scotland on the southern coast of the Murray Firth, and there initially Beaufighters and Mosquitoes, but very shortly the Beaufighters were moved along to Dalkey to form the Commonwealth Wing. There was 404, 144, 489 and 455. Right, the TSETSE did in fact have machine guns as well, although I personally never used the machine guns. But our main armament was this. And this is the shell and shell case of the 6-pounder 57mm gun, and the TSETSE carried 24 rounds of these. The marking on here, the colouring, indicates that it is a tracer and that it is armour piercing, hence the soft nose. There were never any explosive ones. The tracer was rather interesting because when you'd fired it, that you saw this going away from you, you could see the red flame coming out of the back, so you could watch every shell going as it was travelling towards your target. 24 rounds it would carry, but we never ever fired that many. The reason being that on reaching the patrol point off Norway, and incidentally we were always in formation, whereas in the Hamdens during my first tour we were quite often in singles or two or three together only, we were in more bigger formations. One that I was on, there was something like 60 aircraft altogether. What we did was to climb up, because by then we had more or less mastery of the air over off Norway. We'd climb up to 3,000 feet and carry out our patrol there along the coast. On sighting the target ships, the anti-flak boys would go in first, firing their machine guns and cannon, and then the rocket boys would go in, and then we, with the TSETSEs, would bring up the rear. As soon as we were within range, all we had to do was to yell out on the VHF, "Salvo!" which meant all the others, if there were any stragglers, to get the hell out of it because we were going to open fire. And by the time we had dived and lined up at about 2,500 feet, we were ready to fire. In the course of that dive, it was possible to get off six, maybe seven rounds. More than that, not a good idea, because you'd probably hit the mast of the ship. So it was difficult, because whilst you were looking through the gun sight, you also had to look with the other eye to see how near the ship you were. So it was a little bit of a tricky balance. Yes, it was on that trip that there were some shots passing alongside us and overhead from behind, which was not comfortable thought. And that is when I indulged in some crazy flying, of side slipping and diving and going all over the shop. And I thought at the bottom of the dive, because I didn't fire any shells on that trip, that I'd been cool, calm and collected, and that I hadn't panicked or anything like that. But it turned out that at the bottom, on the way down, I must have grabbed hold of all the levers I could, shoved them all forward, and we were doing such a remarkable speed at the bottom that my navigator, who glanced behind to see who it was being unfriendly, said that the tail, in fact, had twisted slightly out of true because of the torque from the extra speed we were doing. We were doing some indecent, getting on for 400. It was dreadful. But years later, I met Wally Woodcock, who was the other survivor, and he said that at the very time that he broke off to chase the bloke off my tail, somebody else had chased a bloke who was on Woody's tail, so it was a sort of almost like a tug of war. But Wally actually saved me that time, and I was happy to buy him a drink years later at one of the reunions.